Hey everybody, do you feel that? Do you feel that? It's today's episode of Games and Coffee. Today we're reviewing Disaster Report 4, Summer Memories. Let's dive right in. Alright, Disaster Report 4 is coming out finally, and if you're a fan of this franchise, the original one was on PlayStation 2, Disaster Report. The sequel was called Raw Danger, also on PS2. And then they had a third one that was never localized in the United States on the PSP. And then they were developing one for the PS3. And in 2011 or so, it got shut down. There were some actual earthquakes that happened overseas and production stopped. But now we fast forward to today. It has been picked up and kind of finished, I believe, from another company. And anyway, what we've got is Disaster Report 4, and I'm a big fan of the franchise. I have been. I played the first two a lot. I was one of the supporters back then when those released. So it kind of breaks my heart a little bit, to be upfront and honest, that this isn't quite what I wanted out of a new Disaster Report 4. And I mean, I say that, but I mean, how do I explain it? There's not enough disaster in it, to be quite honest. But there's other elements to it as well. That said, I do still want to say thank you very much for the review code from NISPR. Absolutely privileged to be able to get a code to review this and talk about it. But let's break it down, okay? So let's start with what I didn't like on Disaster Report 4. The game feels extremely dated, and by that I mean visually, animation-wise, even just the way it feels to control. It feels clunky, it feels obscure at times. There's a lot of different design flaws, I think, with mini games and mini elements to the game, like swimming and when you're captured at some points and scuffling on the ground. And there's just a lot of design decisions where you're sitting there going, what, where do they think this idea was fun? This is just not fun. It's just kind of like obscure and just like just doesn't work very well. And so that is a huge bummer. But again, being a fan of the other games, they were also kind of like that in regards. They weren't very big lookers. They weren't very good controls. You know, just all that stuff I just mentioned. They just it wasn't there for the other games. But what was there was the disaster elements, the grandeur of things falling apart due to earthquakes and all that stuff. And so, you know, that kind of pushed those forward. And we'll get to that. We'll get to the next part here, but there's also a major issue that I have with this game, and it is the pacing. And what I mean by that, it's the game doesn't really ever show you where you need to go or what to do, which is fine, you know, we get that, but this game is very trial and error in that regard. So you might get to an area, right? You might explore the whole area, talk to people, try to go somewhere in an area, and you can't access it, or you can't talk to this person about something. But then you'll talk to another person, and then an earthquake might happen. And then all of a sudden that area is either open or that person has something new to say. And basically it's a rinse and repeat. So as you get to areas with people, you're kind of going through these motions where it's like, okay, you're going to be very methodical. I spent hours probably in certain areas where I just didn't know what to do. And I had to go around. And then I finally found the person I talked to before, but now I didn't talk to after, or I didn't see this area. And suddenly now I can do something new. And it's just really hard to fathom how they thought this was a good idea. I don't know if they were trying to extend the development time, but it is what it is. If you have patience for that, you'll get through it. I did finish this game, so there is that. There is that hope. And those are really the core things I don't like about the game. And I wanted to get that out of the way because I'm always one to look on the bright side of video games, and this is no different. There are some redeeming factors to this game. So I beat the game. It took about 10 hours. There's multiple choices, there's ways to configure your character, how they react. I don't know how much that really changes things, if anything major. Trying to look up some information on this game and seeing how other games played through, I think there might be little things that change, but there's no way to really track it. The game doesn't tell you if you did the game in a different route, did different things. And I know in at least Raw Danger, there was various elements and outcomes to things that you choose. So that being said, let's jump over to what I did like. Obviously, Disaster Report 4 and the idea of these games are, in and of itself, very unique. How often do you get games based on disasters or have any sort of vibe of that nature? And there are moments in this game that are peppered, and I say that, you know, honestly, they're peppered throughout of some disaster elements, like buildings toppling, things falling apart. And they're cool when they happen, and the scale of it, and the way the scale of the buildings and everything falling is really awesome. And those moments are retained like they were in the originals. And the sad thing here, though, is these moments are few and far between. The disasters and the environmental disasters that they occurred in the original games just seem better. I went back and looked at some older games, and they just seem better in the older games than we do here. And they're very minor in that regard here. And I don't really understand. I'm guessing this has to do with the stalled development and the new developer picking it up. And just, this game was like in a development hell. And I feel like this game isn't quite finished. It feels like there are things that are totally missing or not explained or just don't make any sense. For a good example, the game starts off with Christmas music and snow and asks you questions. The thing is, the game doesn't take place during Christmas at all. And it ends on the same note. So it's like, what was the Christmas music for? What was the snow for? Don't know. You have pee. yes, I'm saying. You have pee gauges when you have to pee. And hunger gauges and thirst gauges. And they will come up on your meter. And I really don't know what that does if you don't, like, eat or drink or pee. Because I never saw any negative aspects. Because there were times where I couldn't find a bathroom. I can't believe I was going to say that in a video game. I couldn't find a bathroom to use. And my guy would be holding his bladder or whatever. And there was times where he was hungry and times where he was thirsty. But, again, I don't really know what that did. So, they're there, but I don't know if they impact things in this game. And if they do, it's either so subtle or it impacts maybe how you can react to people. I don't know. They don't explain it. It just isn't explained. But that said, I mean, that again, as you can see, this is where you play this game and you're kind of going, you just go, I don't know why this mechanic is in here or what it is. And there are moments in the game, too, where you get to control, like, a boat. Or you get to control a bicycle, scooter. And carry an old lady on your back. And those are cool parts as well. But they're very short and few and in between. And also, they don't control exactly that great either. We already covered that aspect. But it's just one of those games where you can see the good elements and the things that make this game stand out. And that is one thing I will really say about this game that's a positive. Absolutely will say. It is weird and zany. And okay, I don't want to spoil too much, but let's just say you get involved with a cult. You deal with some miracle water. You meet a wide assortment of odd characters. And a lot of interesting things happen throughout this game. They're just not all that exciting to do them. They're not that exciting to experience them. I would say this game, actually, whereas the other games felt more like platformers of survival in certain ways and elements and zaniness, this one feels almost like it's just more of a story-driven game. And it's actually focusing about half on the disaster at the beginning and the repercussions of the disaster, of how people are handling the disaster, how people are trying to get away from the disaster. And it kind of, you know, is more focused on that in the back half, which was really interesting. I didn't expect that. And again, though, you want to see these disaster things happen, and the game will kind of toy with you, and you'll think you'll get to do, oh, there's a big burning building. Will I get to go in it and help people? No. You know, and I can only think that maybe at some point this game, you know, had these other ideas in place or were going to be developed, and because of the development issues and the pause in development for so many years, it just didn't come to fruition. And so that's the thing about this game. I did enjoy it. I did like it. But I was really frustrated with it a lot. And I wanted more out of this game. And I'm not even saying better graphics or better controls. I've dealt with that before with the franchise, but the disaster elements just seemed so subpar and lacking oomph that they had in the older games, which is just really odd for me. The genre in itself, again, is very niche, and I feel like the audience is still going to be very niche on this. And again, you're going to have fun with this. If you really like talking to people, characters, and kind of being like an errand boy and seeing some of these disasters, you're going to like this game to an extent. But just know going into it, there is a lot of frustration on how to continue on, and you'll be running around for a while. And there's just frustration in the fact that you will be doing tons of talking and listening to the audio and reading the subtitles. There's so much of that. And there's so many choices that you would think maybe there's so many different ways the game can play out, but I'm not getting that impression. And there's so many questions you ask when you're playing. Why do they do this? But yet, here I am playing. And that's probably because Disaster Report 4, along with the franchise, is unlike anything I've ever played in any of these games. And I have yet to see any games really mimic this. So I'd love to see more. I'd love to see more games kind of do this. And we have games that, you know, like Uncharted and those that have those disaster-like set pieces where things are breaking apart. But this game is all about it and the repercussions and everything. And that alone makes the game worth interesting and checking out if you are willing to deal with those concerns. So anyway, I want to thank you all for watching. I want to say again, thank you to Nissan America for providing me the code. I did enjoy my time, even if it sounds like I'm complaining a lot. I really am trying to be as nice as possible while concerning my issues with the game, and there was plenty of them, but I'm still very appreciated that I got to experience it, and thank you again for the code. Until next video, guys, this is Justin signing off. Did you feel that? Okay, no, there was no aftershocks this time. Plus, it's just a camera trick. It just shakes a bunch. That's all.